Gator's legacy, 1988, February 9th. There's no such thing as fear. Fear is a mind killer.
No.
Fear is a little death inside that brings total obliteration. I will face fear. I will let it pass through me and over me. And when fear is gone, nothing will remain. Only I will be here. That's out of a movie. It's not original.
This is the operator. I have a collect call from... Good morning, it's Mark, who is an inmate at a California State Correctional Facility.
I wanted to express my amends. It's been hard over these 10 years to understand how I could become so weak or, you know, so affected that I ended up hurting Jessica Bergston. I was a coward, emotionally and mentally. I hate what I did, and I've hated myself, my life, and my past. Even any good I did before seems to pale in comparison, like wiped out by my crime. All those minutes and hours and days and years since 1991, I've thought about all this over and over again. As for everyone else out there, my former friends, the skate scene, or anybody who looked up to me, I apologize for not living up to that, for making a mess, for going out of control, and for bringing a bad name on skateboarding. If I have... I've read that the past doesn't have to define the future, but it'll definitely be a part of who I am from here on out. I know that.
What do you got in mind for us today, Mark? Where are you taking us?
Well, this is just a casual day at the old Del Mar Skate Ranch skateboarding facility in Del Mar, California. And we're just going to kind of chop it up like a usual day and kind of make the round, swashbuckle in the freestyle area. Maybe do a couple hip hops and maybe get a little courageous in the square bowl or something like that.
I first met Mark at Del Mar Skateboard Park, skating around with all locals back in the early 80s.
He was amazing. He used to own Del Mar. Like, that pool was like his backyard, you know?
You could always ride the worst spots, like in the keyhole, the right wall in the entryway. It's totally kinked and screwed up, but he'd always cruise over it like it was nothing.
To see Gator there on his day, it was truly something to behold.
Gator elicited a certain superstar quality from his fans.
When I first met him, he was skating, and he was skating pro, and he must have been like 14. He had broken teeth from skating, and he was already well on his way, was already sponsored by Vans and GNS.
Kids loved him. They would just run past me and go to Christian, and then Gator. They loved him, and his charisma was like hypnotizing.
Gator all the way, yeah.
He was the best skateboarder. I mean, as a professional skateboarder, that was a big deal back then. Now you see it on ESPN2, and yeah, I know it's still a big industry, but then that was it.
Ever since I was 12 and I saw him go to drink out of a straw, and he goes, "Straws aren't cool," and he hit it, and since I was 12, I was a little kid, just my idol, and then I've always hit it. To this day, you could ask anyone.
Between 79 and 82, skateboarding was really a skeletal sport.
Nobody in the world was skateboarding. In fact, we were the total freaks.
We made $16, $15 a month, $50 a month if we're lucky.
We used to run contests, and the entry fee was 6-pack of beer.
There was no motivation to be really pro. We just enjoyed it, skated, had fun.
It should be a pretty good day out here. We got a lot of different guys from a lot of different areas. And it's kind of funny when you got a little, you know, when you get a guy from Venice, you get a guy from Oceanside and you get a guy from Riverside, you can certainly tell the difference in their forms and styles. And, you know, that's what makes skating unique.
During the early to mid 80s, there were times that we'd hear about a ramp somewhere and just show up and say, we're here to skate. And the guy goes, cool. And you end up spending the night and his mom makes you dinner.
There's weird things that went on like that in the 80s, you know? Well, if we're not home, it's okay. Just please don't make a mess in the yard. Go ahead and skate. And when you leave, put the chain back on the ramp.
It was kind of come as you are. Run what you brung, everybody's cool, have a good time, express yourself. That was a real golden age.
The 80s is when the sport really found itself. As far as what it was gonna be is what those guys did in the 80s with Caballero and Mountain Gator, all these guys developed. It was gonna be getting aerials. And those guys were the pioneers during the 80s.
This whole new rebirth of skateboarding happened, and it was truly the vert craze.
You had guys like Christian Osoy who like blasts up into the sky like an eagle and just really float and just hold that moment and then come down. But then you'd have a guy who blasts up into the sky like an anvil and just be this and then come down and just crack, and then just pull through. And then you have, you know, somebody like Caballero or Tony Hawk that just kind of like did it their own special way, a combination of a couple different styles. I think Gator's contribution to skateboarding is the fact that he rode in a way that stuck in people's minds for anybody who was ever there to see it. A lot of determination. You could tell he was really, really serious about it, dude. You could see it in his eyes, you could see it in his face.
He was one of the kids you could say that this guy really wants it and he's going to work to get there.
He was one of those kids that had the confidence that it took to be good.
Mark was right up in the ranks, and so we were skating against each other all the time. He was always like, you know, top three, top five, and he was one of the guys to beat for sure.
He was skateboarding in the early 80s. He was one of the best all-around skateboarders ever in the history that there ever will see.
I guess I got into skateboarding because it was fun. It wasn't as structured as Little League baseball or Pop Warner football. It was around the time that the skate park opened in Escondido, where I lived, that I got serious about skateboarding. And as a kid, I guess I got good pretty quickly, and I didn't have the good skateboards that other kids in the area had. There were a few shops around the area selling skate equipment. Just the whole experience being near all the new stuff made me want to be sponsored. Skateboarding represented freedom and personal independence and self-definition. Just getting away from the humdrum that was my hometown. And I think chicks dug skating too. So that had its appeal.
Mark Rogowski was our first main rider. We picked him up at one of the contests. Mark and I went and we took a walk on the beach and had a talk and talked about what he wanted to do and where he wanted to go. And we shook hands and pretty much took off from there.
He was going to go to this new skateboard company. I was like, are you sure this is really a good business move? And he did it. And wow, I mean, like, that was really, I mean, business-wise, I don't know what it did for him in his life, but I mean, he just took off.
Back then, there weren't that many pro skateboarders, so it was easy for a company to focus on promoting one skater.
His vision exploded as skateboarding exploded. He was at the right place at the right time.
Mark actually kind of became an icon for the company. We used him so much in everything.
The first time I saw Gator was in Skate Vision's video in a skate shop. They had it just playing in the shop.
The new thing of the 80s that really made those companies super companies was the videos. Huge impact. Kids just sitting in the shop watching videos all day.
Unbeknownst to us at the time, the videos would end up having a huge effect on the popularity of skateboarding because kids that weren't into skateboarding could actually see a video rather than a magazine and go, wow, so that's how they do it. And what that ended up doing is it made skate stars out of this group of kids.
Mark! Mark!
What?
Where are you going?
Skating.
Did you clean your room and make your bed?
Sure,
yeah, sure.
He was amazing as a skateboarder, and they also sort of portrayed him as the rebel rock star of the video. The graphic, everything, the whole, I guess, everything it conjured up for me at the time was really electrifying. I had really good style in that video. I used to lie on my bed at night and put my board up to my feet and totally pose all the tricks that he was doing in that video. I just liked his rebel image.
Skate
around.
All right, let's go.
It's sad to say, but image is incredibly important. I mean, there was kids that were really good, but if they weren't exciting, there was something about them that never caught on.
Everyone was just striving for an image in those days of the 80s and pro skating.
Well, I've been bleached, I've been dyed. I make fashion suicide.
It wasn't always just about the good skating. It was like trying to convey like these guys are weird or they're cool or they're artsy. So Mark just fell right in.
He had just the right combination of edginess in personal style and his actual physical appearance when he skateboarded was perfect. It just spoke so much about him as a person.
Gator was pretty neat. Early 80s, he was great because he was punk and he dressed really cool and he was just nuts. He had a Levi jacket once cut off with different color Vans on.
Actually, one of the reasons I started Vision Streetwear was because of Mark. At the time, we were doing ads with Mark and he was wearing like surf trunks and different things, and he said he used to go to the thrift stores to get stuff, and it just, there was no continuity in the look. So that's when we decided to start Vision Streetwear.
The art department at Vision developed the concept of streetwear, a concept of big logos that in some way were to distinguish the wearer as part of the subculture that was skateboarding.
There was this whole market of skateboarders and they had nothing to identify with.
In a way, it was pretty attractive. At the very beginning, at least, it was pretty attractive to skateboarders because it finally had a way of legitimizing the culture. The mid-80s was the genesis of skateboarding being marketed to the mainstream of American youth. Vision was definitely at the epicenter. For those people on the edge of the skateboarding culture, if you weren't sure you wanted to be a rebel skateboarder, once you saw it in Nordstrom's, you could say, yeah, I accept that.
My name's Mark Rogowski, otherwise known as Gator. I'm 21 from San Diego, California, and I've been into skating for about 10 years. I ride for Vision Streetwear, Vision Skateboards, and Gullwing Trucks. They use my design, this is a design on the bottom of my skateboard that they use for my shorts here. I am furnished with all the necessary skateboard equipment that I need. I'm a design consultant. I design products, endorse them, and my expenses are paid.
Vision was the main advertiser of all the mags, so the more you're in the magazines, the more kids think of you as a superstar. The magazines say this guy deserves this much coverage, and the kids believe and go, wow, he must be the best or super good.
The more coverage you're getting, the more your boards are selling, the more people are seeing you. And every deck that's sold, you'd get anywhere between $1 to $2 a board.
It was like a period of time where you could have easily forgot where you came from, and you're making money, and a lot of money, you know? People made up to $18,000, $10,000, $20,000 a month, just off boards. Made a lot of money. people were taking limos to demos and stuff like that.
The money that came in from all those mainstreamy people was something that most skateboarders had no problem taking. In fact, all these skateboarders were more than happy to receive six-figure checks from board sales.
The guys that were on Vision, like Gator, they had the backing, they had the money, they had the production, but they didn't have someone there to guide them. And I think if they did, I think they would have got a lot further.
The whole team was in Virginia Beach for a major contest there at Mount Trashmore.
There was a lot that happened in Mount Trashmore in 1986.
The cops were all nervous about like throwing t-shirts and sticker toss and that kind of stuff because there was 400 little kids going ballistic, you know, and you know, you throw a bunch of stickers and they all go ballistic and then throw a t-shirt on top of that and it's pretty much a dog pile of kids. We were just laughing, thought it was funny as shit. And the cops were thinking it was not fucking funny.
So here you have this giant event. They got extra security. Gator had taken off when he was gone for a while, probably to his hotel. Comes to the gate, probably didn't have his wristband or badge or whatever it was, and said, no, I'm one of the pro skaters, man. You understand, I'm gonna be riding next, or I gotta get in there. So he just goes right through.
I know I was skating during that time in Trashmore, and I remember there was a big commotion in the parking lot.
Here comes Gator barreling down the driveway, and right behind him is a police car with the lights flashing. And there's Gator, I could just see his eyes just like, just wide open. And he comes spinning around and like goes to get out, and the cops come after him.
Gator's thinking he's a security guard and just turns and punches him.
They took him away.
They precipitated a riot.
All of a sudden, there were some rocks being thrown, and we're standing out there and hear this.
I think kids were throwing rocks at the car. I think kids were kicking the police car and stuff.
Of course, the skater stance is that the cops were overzealous and that he wasn't really causing that much trouble, and so that's what I assumed had happened.
I love that he had the nuts to punch a cop, because he punched a cop in Ramona once going to the ramp, and he waited until the guy got up to get arrested, but he... And then in Virginia, I love that about them. I hate pigs. Like, don't show any cops this, because they'll just come straight here and investigate my life.
Gator, you got any tunes? You got your music? He's gonna whistle. Okay, let's bring him out.
Ride the cold, rise above, we're gonna rise above. Make this score, what we say. Rise above, we're gonna rise above. Try to stop, what we do. Rise above, we're gonna rise above. When they can't do it themselves. Rise above, we're gonna rise above. Way up high, up your abuse. Try to stop us, it's no use. Rise above. Rise above, rise above, we're gonna rise above, we're gonna rise above, we're gonna rise above.
The following month's Thrasher magazine featured a picture of Gator being thrown in handcuffs into the back of a squad car. The moment that Mark punched that cop, in some way it solidified his legend.
Well, I think I need to be interviewed, not only because I'm one of the most elite and dynamic, talented, big-headed, and versatile skaters on the circuit, but also because I'm one of the most blatant and outspoken jerks in the industry. It's really easy to say what you want, what's on your mind, and get away with it when you work for a company like Vision. It's really easy. There's no problems. You can always have a bad write-up in the local gossip column of Thrasher or Transworld, and receive some kind of promotion or exposure from it. It's great.
I love getting arrested. I think I'm one of the most illegal skaters in the circuit, too.
There's always been this cross of skateboarding and rebelliousness. And it's because everywhere you go to skateboard, or everywhere you used to go to skateboard, you were kicked out, told not to do it. If you rode a backyard pool, you're not supposed to be there. You have to climb a fence and sneak in and do it, and you're not supposed to do these things.
In a lot of places, skateboarding was outlawed. I mean, just putting your board down on the ground was considered illegal.
Kids want to rebel. Kids want to listen to music that their parents don't like. They want to perform sports that scare their moms. I mean, that's what kids are like. But the social climate then was remarkably sort of frighteningly conservative. And I think that's why, maybe why skating and punk music and things reacted so far to the left.
We're outlaws, man. We skate with no pads, you know, and that's not a good image to sell, but do we care? No, we don't, you know. We do that because we love doing it, you know. And you damage people's property, but they don't know that we're just trying to have fun.
It's not something that's understood about society. It's now changing.
It's a very thin line between presenting yourself as a true skater and hardcore and not being destructive.
Right after Thrasher did an interview with Gator, they invited a bunch of people to Europe. In Mofo, we didn't have any contest or anything to go to. We just went to Paris and all over to Spain, Italy, south of France, all the way to Amsterdam.
Nothing was planned. It's like, let's just go to Europe, let's stay there, and let's tour around, and let's just go skate everywhere, take photos. The kids were like freaking out when we just show up in their town, like unannounced, and all these top pros were there.
Mark Gonzalez, Gator, myself and Roskop and Hassoy and Caballero, I believe, is a group. And we're supposed to go tour Europe, Mofo style, make sure we go to Normandy on D-Day. And it all broke up because Gator and Hassoy wanted to go see Prince play in Rome. And he's like, we're leaving. And he's like, you leave, you're never gonna get a photo in the magazine again, stuff like that, you know? And they ended up leaving.
And we had a kind of a little schedule because we had to get, you know, from train to train, but they finally made it back to the tour. But they were like so into Prince that they had to go.
Gator ended up telling us, like, we got backstage, went into Sheena E's dressing room. There was a cucumber on the table. I ate it. I ate her cucumber. Like, he was, I don't know, he was the best.
It was fun to hang out with. We had a lot of good times just going to contests and being at contests, because contests were big parties too.
A lot of your popularity was not only based on how well they skated, but how well they partied.
They got pretty crazy. I guess most of them, I was the crazy one though, getting just all liquored up and stuff.
When Gator was drinking, anything could happen. The times that we did party together, it was wild. Always a lot of nudity.
Skated naked, run around the hotels naked in the hallways and things like that. Yeah, you know, just naked. Shock value, it's fun, who knows?
He was on a plane and he stood up in the airplane. He was wearing these tight spandex shorts. And he had a full boner and just was showing me. And I go, God damn it. And he goes, travel boner, who cares? And he walked off the plane with it. With it, it was on him, and hey, it was pretty funny, like, because I would have a heart attack before I did that. It was pretty neat. Not his boner, but actually doing that.
Look at this, look, look. No.
My mommy told me about these. They're condoms. The rubbers. My mom told me about these, but she never told me what they were for.
Let me see, camera.
Let me see camera real quick. I wish I had some. I really do.
Tonight, you're probably feeling
skateboarding guys were a different kind of macho than what you consider like football players. You know they're tough because they take hits and stuff, but they weren't the kind of guys that could scrape their knee off on some fiberglass and get back up and just spit on it and wipe it off and go back. I mean, like, they were just so reckless and so bad boys.
There were kind of two different girls. You had the girls that they liked skateboarding. They were into skateboarding itself. And then you had kind of the rock and roll groupie type girls, the Bettys. They were there to hook up with the skaters.
Yeah, being a skate Betty, I mean, that was cool.
Really, when the whole groupie thing started to come into effect, where we realized that there were girls hanging out at skateboard events, it was just a big shock. I mean, we all grew up as skaters in high school and just as outcasts, you know, no one even cared about us. And then when we all of a sudden, skating got big, and when we get to a contest, it was just like, everyone's just trying to hook up with girls left and right.
Never won so much groupies as wild women that you hooked up and partied with. It wasn't a groupie thing.
Yeah, it wasn't like they're going, oh, this you're Betty, a skateboarder, we're gonna hang out with you. It's all like, fuck, this guy knows how to party, let's roll, let's rage, you know, we're gonna fucking rage. It's all right up front, you know, there's no sales pitch needed.
There was the screaming memes, the chicks that would be, you know, practically throwing their underwear out there.
It was a no effort gig, definitely no effort gig.
Yeah. I would say that Gator was pretty much a ladies' man.
Mark never had a shortage of girls willing to throw themselves in his path.
I mean, they recognized him as a skate stud. He was old enough and beefy enough of a guy, not like this petite little boy. He had the chicks were swooning.
I don't recall him ever, like, being super casual. He did have quite a few committed relationships.
Mark's first real girlfriend was a young lady named Brittany.
They went out pretty intensely for several years.
He was a guy that I met a long time ago when we were in high school, and he had a cute little butt. And he wasn't a pro yet.
She was very grounded, kind of a punk rock girl. She never came across as somebody who is in any way trying to bask in Mark's fame or notoriety. She's just someone who genuinely cared about Mark. She was entirely different than Mark's next girlfriend, Brandy.
Brandy came on the scene, and to her credit, she just was like a representation of an era. She was just part of the packaging.
He had a thing for petite blonde girls that all looked the same. Brittany, Brandy.
I was surprised that Mark would be seeing someone like Randy. However, in retrospect now, I realize that emotionally we are all pretty immature.
When I met Mark, I was 15 years old, and Jessica told me that there was a big skate competition in Phoenix. And we went, and she met Christian Hosoi, and they introduced me to Mark. And it was love at first sight. I mean, we were just so in love. It was puppy love. Of course, I still lived at home. I was in high school. And he would make me little cards and send me something in the mail every single day, call me on the phone. It was sort of this long-distance whirlwind courtship. And this went on for a while, and then he started flying me out on weekends. One weekend when I was out, he had asked me, he said, well, what would you think about moving in together? And I said, well, first of all, I'll have to ask my mom. I mean, I was 17 years old. He drove me out to this magnificent house in Fallbrook. I mean, it was on acreage with avocado groves. It was just beautiful. And he said, you know, would you like to come and live here with me? Well, what girl wouldn't? I mean, oh no, I don't want to move into a $500,000 house. No thanks. I mean, yeah.
All of a sudden, like, all these pro skaters were moving out there.
I bought property in Fallbrook and I built my own ramp. And then Mark moved there, bought his own house, and from what I know, had plans to build a ramp as well.
It was a house that was like living inside a barrel with like a staircase that kind of spiraled up, and every room was like centered off the middle.
It was very circular and it was big.
I think that was at the height of his monetary success. He was being flown to Japan to sign autographs. He had the number one selling board. He was making a considerable amount of money, so we were able to travel, and he spoiled me, and it was what most girls would want, but Mark had two sides. Sometimes the relationship was going just great, and he'd have his little manic freak out and break up with me real abruptly. And then 2 weeks later, call me up, but I love you, and I want to be with you, and we were meant to be.
Skateboarding was really coming into a peak in the late 80s.
By 1987, I mean, you had 5,000 people coming to major skateboard events.
It's the middle of the finals, it's coming down to it. How do you feel?
Stoked, it's great. The skaters love it, the crowd loves it, I love it. It's the best event ever.
I introduced Mark to Bill Silva, whose desire was to start a management company representing skateboarders and what they now call extreme athletes.
They wanted to give skateboarders basically like agents, similar to acting and things like that.
It was totally unheard of. We were definitely seen as an unnecessary evil by the manufacturers.
When Mark signed up with Bill Silva, Bill started marketing Mark in a different way.
We created a tour that went out called the Swatch Impact Tour. It took Gator and Chris Miller and a number of other top skateboarders at the time and actually toured it like a rock show would tour to try to give that kind of exposure and raise the level of awareness to potential advertisers of how much of an audience there really did exist in the youth market.
America has got it now. The heartland of the United States is stronger than California when it comes to these sports right now.
I don't think anything in the past has been able to deal with skateboarders and now freestyle bicyclists and their attitudes and their lifestyles and really show it as what it is.
And nobody at that time, I don't think, really had the balls to actually get something like that going. And Bill decided to take it on. And, you know, we get this huge killer ramp made that's just like one of the raddest things back during that time. Some of the shows, I think one of the New York shows, we got like 8,000 people then. I mean, that was crazy for back then.
Well, tonight it should be pretty good.
Yeah.
We've got a big audience. Most of the audience have been, upwards towards 10,000. And they're all really, they participate a lot. They're really involved with it. They get a lot of yells. And they should, because this is a Baryshnikov ballet of skateboarding, where we brandished our boards on the ramp, baton style, just fully going for it. And it's choreographed. It's not just a demo.
What are you gonna do tonight?
We're gonna rock the house to the live DJ traveling with us. We're gonna enjoy the videos show. We're going to do our 8-to-2-man choreographed routines in daredevil fashion. And we're going to have a whole heck of a lot of fun.
Gator was clearly a star of the tour, and we created a huge press image for him.
A number of skaters presented themselves more as pop stars rather than athletes. And, you know, there was a good reason for that, because the act of skateboarding falls somewhere between artistic expression and athleticism.
This was kind of the beginning of, if you want to call it, rock stardom, trying to take these guys to another level, which is great, but it was hard for them to deal with in some ways.
If I ever beef hard enough to slam and die on a McTwist, it'll read upon my epitaph, in the skate cafe no bill is due, long as proud gravity is our waiter. For we've left our tips, we've had our beefs, and Mod Nature knows we've paid her.
All you groovy guys and groovy gals out here in Daytona,
I was really surprised the way that, you know, they had these guys, they introduced them, they were all like rock stars, they were all dressing really flamboyant. I was just like, wow, this is pretty big.
Welcome to another edition of Club MTV Downtown. Julie Byrne with you in the place to be.
Impact Tour had taken off. I watched those guys on TV, Mark and a few others, and they were on the MTV Downtown Julie Brown show or whatever, and they were hanging out. They just did some kick turns on a ramp. She was like their best bud and stuff, and I'm here with Mark Gator.
Okay, we're gonna come back with something really different, aren't we, Gator? What are we gonna see?
Stay tuned for some ripping ramp riding on the floor.
Okay, we got the skateboarding, the squat skateboarders when we come back.
Later, I talked to Mark about that, like, how was that? And he was just like, he wanted to talk to her, I guess, you know, because he was doing his whole acting thing and everything then, so he probably thought he was like on the same level as her. She wouldn't talk to him, she kept avoiding him, running away from him. Whenever the cameras were off, she would have nothing to do with him.
Oh, Swatch Impact, like, I thought, okay, wow, it's all bad.
Looking back on it, I think that Mark was a little big for his britches in thinking that he was some, you know, demigod because he was a skateboarder.
Okay, go Gator.
Action.
There you guys go. Go.
Everyone had been blown up so quickly. I just remember him really enjoying the celebrity of being a pro skater.
He took it upon himself to make it his mission to get good, not just at skateboarding, but at the entire business and marketing and presentation of the sport. You know, how do I become celebrity? And he really studied it to the point where he got very good at it, maybe too good for his own benefit.
He probably actually believed in that lifestyle. And I used to trip out on these guys, like, what are you? We're just goons that got lucky, you know? Like, none of us are anything.
His business car said skateboarder extraordinaire. When that whole era of his career started, there was a change, and he really fell into it.
Hi, my name is Gator, and spending most of my waking hours on a skateboard, my other modes of transport must be happening. Let's take a look at the Gator Casbah. Let me show you this. We all need a place to crash. My hairstylist. All this walking's getting me thirsty. Had a cooler, but it was too small. I needed some serious shock absorbers for this thing, but I guess it was worth it. What do you think?
Hey, Gator.
Spare. Well, Bloods, there we have it. Not saying that those are the fruits of professional skateboarding, but keep it up.
It was just a total fucking trip to meet Gator because he was totally not what I had like. You know, you read about people and you build a deal in your head, and I'm just like, hey, what's up? Oh my God, I was fucking blown away. You're such a dick, you know?
In answer to the question, do I have an identity apart from skating? It would definitely be no. I am a skater. I live it, I breathe it, I sleep with it.
And I remember I was looking at a magazine one day and all of a sudden Gator came out with an ad that said Mark Anthony. I was going, wow, he's changed his name.
It's weird because he was well known as a professional skater as Mark Rogowski, so I didn't really think why he would need to change his name. You know, it would just confuse people.
There's no Mark Anthony, dude. You're Gator Rogowski, man. I know who you fucking are.
Wasn't Mark Anthony some sort of prince character or something?
I remember him making a big deal out of the fact that he didn't really know who his father was, so why was he carrying his father's name?
I mean, it just seems like a desperate ploy to try to reinvent himself, I think, is how people looked at it.
By then, you just knew he was pretty ungenuine. I didn't know if he was Prince or the skater formerly known as Weird Al Yankovic or Gallagher, who knows?
When he changed so dramatically, everyone was, you know, repelled. This is now someone that's fake and has a front and has an image.
All the kids, us kids, really hated the Vision commercials and stuff they would do.
With the Vision streetwear bullshit, it really wasn't that cool. He looked like a goon. He totally went south. This is what's fucked, is when he totally was like dancing on a Vision video. Like, I punch cops, I'm crazy, I'm hard ass, don't fuck around. And now I'm dancing with puffy pants on. And
it got pretty ridiculous. They had like cut out pictures of him at the shops and, you know, like life size figurines and whatever.
There's these commercials where he's like rigged up to a whatever. You know, he's like on a, I don't even know what to call it, like a hammock. He's just tied up in bondage gear and stuff.
Skaters became pawns, and overnight the market said, you sold out.
It's just a natural way when something gets big, people tend to look for an underdog. Mark should have recognized that sooner and aligned himself with another manufacturer who was more on the cutting edge.
You are a moron if you were wearing Vision streetwear. I mean, flat out. You were a lot more cooler if you went to the thrift store and grabbed a pair of $2 shorts and a t-shirt that cost a quarter. It was just breaking away from all that glamour shit.
At the same time, there was a whole generation of former professional riders and amateur riders and people who are connected to companies who decided that they wanted to shake things up and strike out on their own.
The industry got flooded with little companies.
Many of these companies went into direct competition right away with the big, slow-moving corporate entities like Vision.
Vision had this huge warehouse, and it was just ridiculous. I mean, motorized clothing racks and just the whole deal. And when we actually saw it was frightening to think of the skateboard company was this huge. And that doesn't lend for any changes at all. And skateboarding's an up-and-down thing. Skateboarding goes down and you're that big, you're fucked.
We probably made a mistake as a company and hung on to Vert way too long and was not aggressive enough to start with the street skaters.
What was happening is skateboarding was reinventing itself from the 80s into the 90s. We started seeing these kids develop ollies on the flat ground and doing all these, what we were calling street tricks. So we started promoting what was called street style. Into a new realm, a new dimension. Pay close attention. We could see ahead that this is the thing that every kid can do.
When skate parks got closed down, Del Mar got closed down, Upland got closed down, but we took skating into the streets and they named street skating. Hip-hop lovers can't get enough of this.
Black tracks on wax are so smooth, you can't help but start to move. They definitely pushed it towards the street, and it's smart marketing-wise because you cannot go and skateboard in swimming pools when they don't have swimming pools in Iceland, you know? But you can go and ride the skateboard down the cobblestone road still, and you can bounce off a rail or a wall.
Street skating became the hot thing to do. Vert skating was completely out.
There was still another group of vertical skaters coming in, but there was a billion, like, great street skateboarders coming in.
And street skating was different than the way Gator would street skate, or any pro skater current at that time.
the Vert guys, were really the rock stars. The street thing was definitely a different vibe, more subdued, more down with the people kind of thing.
People put you on a pedestal, and he was an idol, like, and then you're not that big of a deal anymore. Disposable hero. Just see you later. And it's fucked. It's so lonely. You don't know, okay, really, I'm 21, and they're just done with me, and I don't even know how to get a job. I moved out when I was 17. It's pretty fucked, alienated, it's rad.
It was just a weird time in skateboarding that skateboarding had never actually gone through, so it's like a weird, you know, for you to be a vert skater, it was just like, you know, where do I go? You know, no one wants us around anymore. Like, everybody loved us last year, and now they hate us.
It's probably one of the roughest times to be a professional skateboarder, and just to be in the industry, it was kind of bleak, it was kind of dark, and, you know, it was obvious the gravy days were over.
Vert skating was losing popularity. My photo coverage in all the magazines was getting less and less. I felt invisible. Not being a big skate star anymore. It was a major life transition, or crisis time for me.
He was coming out of his forming years, having a lot of success, a lot of recognition and renown, and possibly a bit of confusion with his own identity.
There was a lot of conflict in who he wanted to be and who he really was. He was protecting himself from being reminded that he was still Mark. He wanted to hang with people that told him that he was Gator.
As hard as he tried to fit in, I don't think he ever really did. He appeared to be an outsider. Like when we were at home in Fallbrook, he didn't want to go hang out at Tony's house. He didn't want to, leave those guys to themselves. They're having a good time playing their Nintendo. I'll sit here and write music or, you know, write a poem.
I never felt like you could get so close to him, that he would actually let people in to be that close to him.
You know what song that is?
I've heard of it. What? I know it. Is this song from R.E.M.?
Charlie laughs and it's raining all day. She loves to be one of the girls. She lives in a place in the side of the mind. Nothing has ever been straight. She turns herself around and she smiles and she says, this is it, it's the end of the joke.
Mark really disenfranchised himself in the end and just was completely severed from everybody else, you know, and maybe losing his self.
You know, he went and bought a huge house in Fallbrook and everything and was all set to build this monster ramp and have this great lifestyle out there. And then, like, all of a sudden, the next day, vert skating was out.
The money wasn't there and the fame was waning and it was just, you know, it was a moment in time that was starting to be over.
Seems really, really strange. Like, he has this huge house, and it's just, you know, I felt like there was some kind of a, like, buying stuff and not being able to fulfill something.
Just was filled with all sorts of useless gadgets at the time I thought were useless. Like, you know, he had a fax machine. Him and Tony Hawk would just put their butts on the fax machine and, like, send butt faxes back and forth.
Fallbrook's weird. I mean, I just got sick of living in the boonies, and from what I know, I think he did too.
It really got to me. Being out in the middle of those avocado groves at night by myself a lot of times. And I kind of felt like he liked me to be isolated. He was very possessive over me. Didn't want other people looking at me. Very possessive.
Gator checking his mail.
I'm a winner.
What are you trying to do? What are you looking at? What are you laughing at? Are you making fun of me? God, aren't you gonna miss this house, man? Waking up in the morning and walking out nude?
I can still walk around nude.
He was trapped out in the middle of nowhere, lonely out in the, you know, avocado fields, going, man, what am I doing here? No one would drive up there and hang out with him. It was so far away.
It was nice to have ramps. My ramp started getting wrecked, and so I moved back to Carlsbad in a house that I owned all along. And I know that he moved to Carlsbad near the beach.
He cruises back to the coast, tries to street skate, and kids laugh at him. And he was desperately grasping at straws, trying to figure out what would work to get him back to the lifestyle he used to have. And then slowly just got worse and worse, and he did worse and worse things.
There was a tour of Australia where we were getting calls almost daily that Mark was aggressive in his behavior. He was throwing boards at kids.
That's when Gator was spending a lot of time with this trainer guy, and he was getting pretty intense about his diet and things like that.
The guy didn't have broccoli, fresh broccoli for him, and he threw a big fucking tantrum. He was super mad, and I thought he was such a baby. Because fresh broccoli, who gives a fuck? Fuck limits in your life. Just eat corn dogs, who cares?
I guess he did a bunch of demos, like, all in a row. He was just getting really worn out, tired, frustrated. And some kid had come up to him and asked him for an autograph. I guess Gator shoot him off, like, no, stop, don't bug me, I'm just, you know. And the kid was pretty persistent about it. Gator's hauled off and hit him, socked him in front of a bunch of people. And people were just pissed. They just couldn't believe that, like, you know, who's this, you know, American hotshot skateboarder comes to Australia, think he can punch kids.
When he came home, he shrugged it off and didn't recall or didn't pay much attention to it.
His sales in Australia dropped, just instantly fell off. Anger management, you know, he just didn't have a grasp of it very well.
I remember that was sort of the beginning of people going, that guy's a prick.
I didn't realize that his father had had such a bad effect on the kids. His father had a rage problem, and Gator, he also had a rage problem and had had a rage problem all along.
Mark had some psychological issues that were there all the time. We just didn't recognize them. Just the way in which his trigger was so quick, you know, his anger would spark up in a second.
Mark certainly came from a family that was broken early. He had a lot of resentment and anger towards his father for abandoning them. I think he had shame at times around his behavior around his mom when he couldn't fulfill the good son expectation. But it became very clear to me early in our relationship that he wasn't addressing those issues, and further, that he seemed to have a problem with alcohol.
All of his drinking and whatever he did was not really in the name of fun so much as just controlling his rage.
And what I remember is the summer of 1990, we were in Germany, the entire Vision team at the World Cup event. And one night, Mark got so drunk that we lost him somewhere along the line. I remember looking out my window and seeing Mark had climbed up this, what looked like a construction crane.
He got shit-faced on Jägermeister and took a swan dive out of a hotel room. He did right in front of Hogan and landed on a fence.
He showed up at my room bleeding profusely, torn flesh everywhere, his neck, his hands. I always remember the sound being like someone pouring soda out of a can, but it was actually blood. Finally, we get him into the ambulance and we go to the hospital, and he's just in so much pain, and he's so drunk, and he turned into a madman. Almost seemed like he was on some superhuman drug like PCP or something. They got him all shot up and stitched up. The next morning he got up and said, fuck, what happened? And it was just unbelievable that he had no concept of where he was, how he got there.
I think that's what kind of made a turning point for Gator, as he turned around to kind of straighten his life out, realizing that he was kind of blowing it.
During 1990, as I recall, I mean, my life should have been stable, but I had, you know, a drinking problem. The accident in Germany seemed to coincide with my having, like, local Carlsbad Christian surfers preaching Jesus to me on the beach and on the boardwalk. I was receptive, you know, because I felt that my life at that time was missing, you know, purpose, meaning, direction, or whatever. I started reading the Bible, day and night, you know, being with Christians, praying a lot. But at the same time, I was very frustrated, feeling the forces that pulls in two opposite value systems. So at the time, I was trying to use the Gator image in skateboarding as a tool to evangelize, to, you know, win souls to Christ. It wasn't until I, you know, accepted Christ or converted that I really began to get an honest look at how screwed up I was inside, how lonely I was, dissatisfied with my life and my career. I wanted to escape from all the meaningless of my image and go back to school, get a life apart from skating.
Everyone was just pretty much rolling their eyes, like, okay, here's another one of his little things he's gonna go off on.
I mean, I saw him a couple times, and it was like, with his Bible, it was like, oh wow, that's a new gimmick. Look at me, I'm a born-again Christian, I'm gonna save all the other little kids.
I found out when I walked up and he had 30 kids sitting down on the floor. It was a Shut Up and Skate, Dallas. Yeah. And he walked in and he's reading shit out of the Bible to him.
I go, you know, we're about to go smoke a bowl, man. You want to come with us? You know, go get some beer and hang out. We'll skate another session you want. No, I got some more, you know, scriptures to read. I'm like, sure, I bet you do, man.
I think that his search for who he was is part of what, you know, thrust him into Christianity. It's what thrust him into the star and the spotlight. It's what thrust him into the sport.
I didn't really know what it meant. You know, I just thought that he really maybe needed some direction, and I felt like he was having a really hard time with skating's demise. I really felt that in my heart, that he was trying to hang on to his career still and his celebrity, and it just wasn't working out.
Before the Christianity thing and before he started really showing his manic chemical imbalance stuff. Yeah, I thought that Mark and I would get married and have lots of kids and live happily ever after.
I hate to say it, but for years before, our relationship was mainly about sex. I led her on in different ways and used her, I admit.
He wanted me to become a born-again Christian, too. He wanted me to go to chapel and hang out with all of these little virgin girls that, you know, hold their hands up in the air and accept Jesus into their body. I mean, it was weird to me.
I wanted everything about us to change, bam, like that, instantly. But she wasn't ready for that and couldn't believe how I'd come to believe.
He told me, he said, you know, I think that maybe you're just too young for me. We don't want the same things. And he said, and I really just want to settle down and go to church. And that's when I went out and I met this guy, and he was my age. He's really good looking, and he was a surfer, and I even got close with his mom, and I mean, just a great guy. And Mark decided one day that he didn't like that.
I let my hurt fester, especially the part about her rebounding into another relationship with a younger, handsome surfer guy. I think I'd become fixated to this patriarchal, biblical idea of women as property, submitting to their men.
He started following me, and even it went as far as to where I was at this guy's house one day, this guy's mom's house, and the phone rang, and it was Mark. He had, like, traced me to the house. He was stalking me, is what it was. He was stalking me. He had broken into my parents' home and stole everything that he ever gave me, my car that he had given me, left very threatening messages on the phone. My mother and I were both very scared of him.
Here you have a situation with a young kid who had never been dumped before, and it was devastating to him. And so consequently, he made some very bad choices. One of the last statements that he made to her is what he ought to do to her is take her somewhere, commit every sex act that he could possibly think with her, and then dump her naked body in the desert. And so she left, and she essentially went into hiding from him.
I think it was about power. When I ended up with Jessica one night, punishing Brandy by hurting her former best friend.
I met Jessica through a friend of mine in Tucson, and we just instantly got along. I mean, she was really vibrant. She was a lot of fun. I mean, we were both party girls. I mean, we wanted to hang out, it was all about having a good time. You know, when I got the call that she was missing, I didn't even know that she had moved to San Diego. She and I really weren't in contact then.
She was recently, had come to San Diego from Arizona, and she really wasn't a part of any scene as it was, like Gator was.
Jessica had Gator's telephone number. So one day, Jessica calls Gator, talks to him, has a long conversation with him, and wanted him to introduce her to the party scene up here in North County in San Diego.
He was going through this thing where he really wanted some acceptance out of that fast world. When she called him, he wasn't sure what was going on.
From what I understand, they went out to lunch, came back to this place in Carlsbad.
The girl was trying to entice Gator at that point. He drinks a little wine. He hasn't been doing any drugs or alcohol for a while, so he's really finding his resistance down. He's feeling very pressured. He's feeling the cognitive dissonance of knowing that there's this life. Oh yeah, why not do her, you know, might as well. But at the same time, you know, this is not the thing to do religiously.
I've been meaning to seek psychological counseling, but the brand of Christianity I was immersed in at the time, you know, ridiculed psychology. You know, as if Jesus could heal everything and Satan, the source of my depression. After I turned myself in, a psych diagnosed me as severe manic depressive, you know, bipolar disorder. Jessica didn't deserve my anger. I let my pain out on her, even though she was innocent. And early that morning, you know, somewhere between 2:30 and 3 a.m., this weird impulse just took off. I just suddenly snapped and lost control. And all this rage came out of me.
He did turn himself in. Of course, that doesn't take away from what he did, but obviously the guy felt deep within himself that what he had done was terrible.
He willingly gave up his rights, thinking that this was his path to true religious, I don't know, accomplishment, to be saved, to be forgiven.
He had laid out very succinctly what he had done, where, how, when, and all the way to disposing of the evidence.
The victim was Jessica Bergston, who moved to San Diego just weeks before her body was discovered, April 10th, by a young boy who was riding his four-wheeler in the desert. A neighbor remembers last seeing the victim with this man, skateboard pro Mark Anthony.
The prosecutor said Rogowski was jilted by his girlfriend, Bergston's best friend, and he was out for revenge.
Hits her in the head several times with a club, the type of club that's used to secure a vehicle. It's a security device for the wheel. After rendering her semi-unconscious, he takes her up into a bedroom in his condominium and then handcuffs her, sexually assaults her for approximately 3 hours. At the end of the sexual assault, deciding she was making too much noise and in fear that the neighbors might hear her cries for help, placed her inside of a surfboard bag. And while inside the surfboard bag, then strangled her.
Jessica was absolutely beautiful. Jessica had the prettiest eyes. I can't wait. Can you stop it for a second?
The first boards are the picture of how Jessica was found. Because of the elements in the desert, this is what Jessica looked like. She was basically unidentified. Ultimately, we were able to get a set of fingerprints from the Sheriff's Department in Arizona where Jessica had had a juvenile record, and that was what we were able to identify her by. These four photos are photos of one of the search warrants that was conducted in Gator's apartment. Gator had talked about the fact that she was on the downstairs behind the couch, sitting on the floor getting ready to leave, when he hit her in the head with a club.
And in photograph D, this was actually luminol that reacts with the proteins and the amino acids in blood. And then when photographed under a black light, it fluoresces. And you can almost see the outline of where she was laying, the heavy concentration. The upper right-hand square would be where her head was, and then some cast off from the instrument. Number 12 shows the area where the criminalist cut out, and the blood had actually soaked all the way through the carpet, through the padding, and down into the wooden subfloor underneath. This photo board was the upstairs bedroom. Gator had talked about taking her up to the bedroom and committing all of the sex acts in the bedroom. And he had talked about the fact that at one point in time, Jessica was actually on the floor.
He sent me a couple postcards. It pretty much said that, like, you know, the truth will come out and God, you know, will show my innocence.
One of the interviews that I did with Gator, he suggested to me that, in fact, it was kinky sex gone bad, that they were having consensual sex, there were handcuffs involved, there was friendly choking happening, and she somehow accidentally died, and he freaked out.
I think that part of this problem all along is denying things he knows to be true because I just think he couldn't take it. He wasn't too in touch with reality.
They didn't have a relationship. He had only seen her 3 times. He didn't want me being friends with her because we were wild together. Of course, he didn't want me hanging out with anyone.
He talked about that he kind of blamed Jessica because Brandy has left and it was easier to blame her than to say, I screwed up.
When I went in there and saw him on the other side of the glass, I could tell he was scared and he just said whatever he could say to make him be out of there.
He always told me that it's all gonna come out in the wash once the trial happens. He was always just like, you know, believe in me, you know, like just wait till the trial. And then, you know, I'm waiting for this trial date and stuff, and then all of a sudden he just said he was guilty and went off to prison.
How do you plead to that charge as to first degree murder? Guilty.
We were able to get around the death penalty, but he was looking at life without the possibility of parole. So if I was able to negotiate something less than that, rather than try and go to trial and possibly get convicted, we negotiated down to first-degree murder, which would give him an opportunity for parole after about 17 years.
Before sentencing, Mark Gator Anthony, who claims to be deeply religious, made an appeal for Christian mercy.
I've only been a glimpse of the family's sorrow, I'm sure. I sincerely hope that they can accept my apology for my carelessness. I'm sorry to Jessica. No one deserves to have a dearly loved one taken from her. I never wanted Jessica to die. And I am deeply sorry.
Anthony was sentenced to 6 years for rape, and once he completes that, he faces 25 years to life in prison for the murder of Jessica Bergston.
Oh, he deserves it. He definitely deserves it. I don't think, I think he should spend the rest of his life in prison.
If I was him, the attorney dad, or the girl's dad, I would dedicate my life to fucking Mark Rogowski.
I just hope that he realized how he affected everyone's life. It really has affected a lot of people's lives. And not just, I mean, her family, my family. It just ripped us all apart.
I wanted to tell him that I couldn't stand him. Like, I wanted to tell him things. Hey, remember this? You're fucked. Like, I wanted, but then I realized he's pretty fucked. He's stuck in there with just, it's fucked in there, probably.
Over the years, I've tried in my mind to put myself in her family's shoes. I'm sorry for
stealing your child from you. I'm not the same person I was in 1991. I'm confident that while I'm not perfect,
your call will be terminated in 2 minutes.
I've done a great deal of deep soul searching and personal work. I just know myself better these years. I'm taking care of myself now. I'll never hurt anyone again. I know that.
That incident was a big turning point in all of it for me. I didn't really believe in what I was doing anymore in the whole skateboard thing. I walked away. I walked away from the whole skateboard world, and I just couldn't do it anymore.
I thought that it was going to do more harm to the sport of skateboarding, because I think people were going to focus on that more, like, oh, he was a skater, he murdered somebody.
I think that's one of the things, too, that people were bummed about, is that he was such an ambassador for skateboarding.
I felt that he was, because I might have been going through the same stuff at the same time, thinking, like, you know, what are we doing? We put all this into it, and now it's leaving us. We're not getting it. We don't have any of it anymore. They're giving it to these new guys. Like, what do you do with yourself when your fame's gone?
You know, fame is one of the worst drugs of all.
I think that drove a lot of pros to, you know, one for suicide, you know, one for murder, and a couple are in jail. I guess it's just some people just couldn't make the transition.
A lot of wayward kids get involved in skateboarding. I don't know why, but they do.
I don't know, man. A lot of us come from dysfunctional families. A lot of us, you know, I don't know. I went through the system. I got sentenced. They gave me 5 years. I did 27 months. My first 8 months, I got sent up to Soledad, and I went in there, and Mark was there. So I used to meet him at church every Sunday. And I asked him if he missed skateboarding. He was like, nah.
When a kid has had like a 4-year run, and all of a sudden, there's a new batch of kids coming up, and they're getting replaced. That's a terribly hard thing to confront when you're a kid, because you're looking at your life and going, where is everybody? And if you don't have somebody that can hold your hand or pat you on the back or say, look, your time's kind of coming up, but we're going to help you move into the business, you're left holding nothing. And it's not just skateboarding. You see it in acting, you see it in music. They give these kids and these performers so much false importance. And I wonder if any of what they've experienced has been worth it after that. Was that 4 years worth what it's done?
Back in the day, back in the 80s, he was a big-time skater for Vision. He's gone, and skateboarding has progressed. And basically kind of left him in the dust, and he's rotting in jail. I guess it's not like riding a bike. You never forget. He'd be out there doing big boneless over the transfer, big acid job, and, you know, all that good stuff. He'd probably trip out all on the new boards. I'm sure you've seen him in mags, you know, but whoa, look at that. Oh, you can do all kinds of stuff. The skateboarding is blowing up.
Like now, it's huge. It's way bigger than it ever was. But it's the same if you look at it demographically. It's the same bunch of kids not wanting to do football, baseball, basketball. There's more of an individual type of scene.
A lot of skateboarders are running all the companies now. Everybody's looking out for skateboarding as a whole. A lot of people depend on it, you know, for a living. And it's just what we all grew up doing.
Today, skateboarding is so popular that I think kids find skateboarding now, and it's just a big sport that everyone does.
I think if people are smart and people look back at the past, they will know that people that stick with something will likely succeed sometime. But anything, I mean, if you're gonna be in for the quick buck, then be ready to be out, you know? But if you're true to yourself and true to the sport, no matter how bad the bad times are, you'll make it through the good times.
it gets to a point where you don't realize that it's a privilege to be a professional anymore, and you just like start believing your own fairy tale, because it is just a fairy. It's just a phony fairy tale that it's rad, you know.
Okay, this is an ad, 1988. I looked straight at the Gator board. That was the first board I looked at. And then the next board up is Jeff Phillips, perfect order. And then, fuck, Christian Hosoi, just not too long ago, prison. And then me, so I'm next. It's great, can't wait.
Can I get my trunks and stuff?
What's that on?
How are you? Okay.
I didn't know she was the mayor's daughter. No, I'm sorry. Who is that? What's it all about?
You bet it's going to be an exception or you're going to make it.
Find a nickel, pick it up. And in the jam, you'll have good luck.
This is a genuine George and Capital.
It's a genuine kind.
It's not wooden, but my teeth are. Actually, I don't know. It's kind of a matter of just skaters. Now's the time it's come. We should bow our heads and beseech the skate lord, Tony Hawk, for a little guidance. And ask our fair lord to have a little forbearance on us tomorrow, and maybe we can have a little chance of doing good in the contest. Thank you. No, I guess.
Tony the one to beat?
Yeah, he's the one.
What's he doing this time? Anything different?
I don't know. It seems like he could get his most eclectic synthesis of tricks and make about four different runs out of them, you know, doing different tricks the whole time. It's probably just a matter of combining bioness with, you know, innovation. Against Tony, that is, because he's on top of it always, you know. He's a leader, but then again, there's, you know, Wilkes and Blender and Grohlski, a couple of those lip masters out there that are just playing all over that lip and turning everybody's head, you know, every time they skate, because they're the harbingers of the avant-garde, you know.
So you've been skating a lot of years. How long do you think you're going to keep on skating?
I'll be skating forever, generally.
Competing forever?
That's a different story. That is a totally different story.
Do you ever get burned down?
You know. Do I ever get burned out?
Think about doing something else?
You don't get burned out on skating. You know, it's too fun. It's like a rush. It's like my livelihood too. So yeah, that kind of matters.
Anything you've been working on for this competition? Different? Anything? New tricks?
I got a few new ones. Something probably that I shouldn't mention. One's in anti-Germany, and Ken Park knows what I'm talking about.